it's amazing how we can turn around our attitude instantly by just focusing on the wow and saying like, wow, I've got it. Or, you know, wow, I know I'm already saved. Wow, I know that instead of struggling with what you're feeling, go right to the wow. So I'm thinking, I had so many insights today, I can't remember them. Just say, hey, wow, I've got it. You know, I really understand. Wow, it's working. Focus on the wow, and that will immediately take you out of the doldrums into sort of this elation, and you'll start feeling this elation mixed with some fear, but it's no longer in the realm of struggling. It's no longer in the realm of struggle. Okay, so this is what we're doing. We're taking ourselves out of the realm of struggle. Now, as God is my witness, this next event took place. I don't make up situations that I experience, or quote unquote situations. I'm in my vehicle in a parking lot, and a man walks in across the parking lot, and he's waving this $20, this looks like money. And he says, and I say, what the heck's going on? He comes right up to me, wants to talk to me. So I roll down the window. He says, I got a $20 question for you. Then he starts asking me this technical question about building. I don't have a clue. I don't know how to answer, but nice smile, say yeah. And I try to help him. And there's a man about my same age. And then I find out what he does for a living. He mentions it, and he starts talking about that. Well, here's where it gets interesting. He ends up giving me a wealth of information, insider information, about what we have been talking about in the previous videos. Verifying it. Now, I don't know this person from Adam. Just imagine someone, you're in your vehicle parked in the parking lot. Someone comes up to you like with great urgency. Hey, I got to talk with you. And they end up verifying everything that you think that you believe that is going to happen. They say, hey, I'm an insider. I know what's going on. So this is what happened today. You talk about serendipity. You talk about a miracle. This is it. And I was just like, wow. Did this happen? Yes. Why does this happen? Because the more we evaporate continuity fear, the less we need to worship time. Okay. And more miracles come to us. Now, what did he say? Get this. He's a prison guard. He knows what's going on in the world of criminality, in the world of drugs. A vast wealth of information. He knows what's going on, not only here, but other places. And he talks about what's really going on is an invasion of this area, for instance, of gangs. They're spreading out all over. And I have another friend who's moving. He told me, it's an amazing thing. Get this. One friend tells me day before yesterday or whatever about he has to move because his area has been infiltrated by terrible, terrible criminal gangs. And he said that the kids that used to walk the street, nice kids, you know, playing games, enjoying life, etc., now they're all walking around like gangsters. And you're in mortal danger from them. He said the whole place has just gone to hell. And he actually finally he's moving. I said, well, that's great, he's moving. So he's getting out of there, and he says it's sickening, it's completely ruining his life. Well, then 2 days later, this man walks to me in a parking lot. He turns out to be a prison guard, and he knows where all these gang members come from. And then he tells me where they live in these pockets of these nests of gangsters, and he mentions the very place that my friend lives. Well, and it's moving out. He says that whole area has been completely ruined by gangsters. Now, he talks about drugs, and I told him, you know what, I think there's going to be a major drug epidemic coming up. And he says, absolutely. He said, it's like tides, it's cyclic. Every so often, there's this very strong punctuation of drugs. He knew the whole story front and center. He's had a front row seat to the whole thing, being in law enforcement and taking care of all these criminals, terrible criminals. And he said, it's coming. Absolutely. Can you? I'm just like astonished at what's happening. And he mentions, I forgot, PCP. Terrible problem with PCP. These criminals are heavily into drugs. They move drugs into neighborhoods. I mean, the whole thing, he said, it's cyclic. He said, it is cyclic what happens in society. He said, I'm a huge believer in there are these cycles. And this is what we're talking about, that there's going to be another cycle. There's a first one, the second one, and then the third one. And the third one is just off the charts. Now, as I'm leaving, or actually I introduced him to somebody, got out of my vehicle and treated him like a VIP because he gave me incredibly important information, including the spread of methamphetamine throughout the United States. In places, in small towns, he says, you would not believe it. The small towns used to be so beautiful, a couple thousand people. They're decimated by methamphetamine use because the people are bored. They have nothing to do. They take drugs. It's rotted the whole country, he says. It's way worse than we know. It's rotting the minds of the country. This is true. Wow. And he actually has had a house and property in a small town, in a state in the country. You'd think that was like perfectly free of all problems. This is the second person that's told me about this kind of thing out in like the Midwest, the North Midwest, you know. And he says, no, it's decimated by methamphetamine. They stole everything. They took everything. It's horrible. This is rural, small-town America he's talking about. Second person that's told me, I asked him, another person told me, like, for instance, from Fargo, North Dakota, I said, how is it that area? Oh, it's terrible. I mean, you think the problems aren't there? Oh, they're here in terrible ways. So, this country, United States, is in big trouble. You have massive amount of people in this country that are used to taking drugs, are willing to take drugs. He said, it is coming. There is going to be a next drug epidemic. This is what I've been revealing here. And this is not all, though. This is not all. He gets even deeper. And then he starts talking about the Fed and how the debt mountain is going to collapse. I didn't even say anything about it. He just suddenly started talking about it. I was just like, huh? He says, when it happens, it's going to happen super fast. There's going to be a super fast money collapse. He says, absolutely there is. He says, that's also cyclic, and that's coming very soon. You know, this is someone who has a different perspective on life than most people do. You have to respect somebody who has spent his life in an area where it, we call it, life gets very real, very intense, very severe, and he sees firsthand, you know, how bad it can be. And he told me how it works. You know, they invade houses during the daytime. This is what's happening in San Jose, Silicon Valley area. They go where the money is, and these people are really, really nasty. There's a huge invasion, he said, coming up from the south, from Los Angeles area into this area, actually. So he knows all this stuff. He says most of the people who are incarcerated actually are in witness protection program, protective custody. And there's two levels of that, regular and high level. He says, why? Because these people are helping criminal investigations, and if they weren't in protective custody, they'd all be killed for sure. And this is right in our little, dear little town. Our city used to be the safest city in America, San Jose, California. It's turning into a nightmare. Okay. Well, this is happening all over the world, actually. So, this is just extraordinary what happened to me. Who's on a $20 bill? That's what he was waving. Andrew Jackson, who's the founder of the Democratic Party, actually. Andrew Jackson. Interesting. Interesting. I saw a picture of him on Wikipedia. And on the $20 bill, he looks so magnificent, you know, where this daguerreotype of him. And he looks terrible. He looks like he's on meth. Honest to God. Meth is a way worse epidemic than people realize. Around the world, the people are cooking up. There are laboratories all over the world, in houses all over the world now, people cooking up drugs. It's extraordinary what's happening in the world. And yet, here he is telling me something is going to happen very soon. He said that's going to be catastrophic. And ultimately, I just said, well, thank you. You know, I should give you money for this information. So I'm passing this on. This is very important information. This is a man who, he told me all about the criminals, how they act, how they behave, how they think. et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he says they spend their time bragging about their crimes. It's like funny to them. They love it. It's like a joke. This is what drugs can do. This is what going down the wrong path can do. So we are getting some confirmation. Now, here's another thing that's going to blow your mind. It blew my mind. I've said before that I had this experience of coming upon an accident in the desert. And then having to go back to this retreat. I was in this beautiful place. I left it. There was a horrible accident. I had to go back to this beautiful place because we couldn't get past the situation. And it was just... And I knew that this had some relevance and timing relevance to the turnover times of terrible time in the world. Now, all four of these guys were heavily using drugs. There's no question about it. They're out in the desert using drugs. So we have a situation, severe drug problem. Okay. They rolled the car, Volkswagen. There's a Volkswagen Beetle. I said, look for a problem with Volkswagen. Well, we just had this massive lie by Volkswagen about their turbo-injected diesel engine, TDI, turbo diesel injection engine, 2.0. So there's a huge scandal with Volkswagen. I knew, look for a severe problem, turmoil with Volkswagen. It's here. Now, the guy lying on the ground that was completely unconscious in severe condition, his name was Murphy, and all the guys kept saying, hey, Murphy, 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 like this, Murphy, Murphy, Murphy. They said it quite a number of times like this. Now, the dream that I had of the collapse, it happened on the 111th, when I said there's a 111th World Series coming up right now. This Pope is the 111th, in one way of looking at it, of Malachi's prophecy of the last popes. There's only one more after this, or this could be the 112th, but some think they call it the 111th. So 111th Pope, 111th World Series, the dream of the collapse on Highway 111. Volkswagen having problems. Now they're calling Murphy, 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 Murphy. That's this guy's name. They tried to kind of keep calling out to him, hey, Murphy, Murphy. You know. Well, if you follow baseball, which I do, and the Holy Spirit knows I do, you would know the Mets' Daniel Murphy has just hit six consecutive games. He's had a home run and seven altogether in the postseason, setting an all-time historic record. It's just absolutely astonishing what Murphy has done. So if you take Murphy's home run, you say, Murphy, 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 Murphy. You know, this is exactly what the people were saying there with that accident. You know, and I got that. I got those chills almost today. I said, oh my gosh. And here's a guy telling me that there's going to be a flash crash, a flash dead crash, coming out of the blue telling me this. And just think about the turmoil and all these gangs that are in the country now, and how absolutely crazy they are. This is a trouble coming. And people, and likely the country being flooded with drugs, and I believe there's going to be some new drugs coming onto the scene. So, I'm saying, wow, the Holy Spirit is saying there's a timing mechanism here, and look, it's being fulfilled. It is being fulfilled. Now, you know, when the Holy Spirit gets your attention to something, it's personal. So it's going to use symbols that you can personally relate to. Okay, but it will also use, you know, it's talking about Volkswagen, of course. Well, we all know Volkswagen, but the Murphy thing, not everybody is going to be following baseball, so a lot of people don't know anything about it. But I'm sure anybody who follows baseball now knows about Daniel Murphy and what he's done, which is absolutely extraordinary. Nobody expected it. And here's another very important clue. Something is going to happen that nobody expected. It's going to be way stronger than anyone expects. Daniel Murphy, for God's sakes, hit 14 home runs in the regular season. He is no power threat by any means. And he's a rather small guy. He's the last person in the world you think that would be doing this. I mean, I call him the cannon right now. I mean, what else are you going to call him? I was calling Schwarber from the Cubs the cannon because he hits it so far, but you might as well call Murphy the cannon. I mean, every ball he hits is over the fence. And any baseball fan is just like saying, this is just astonishing what's happened. I can't believe this. This guy is now taking over in October like nobody's business. is really without precedent with what he's doing. It's just reached a point of almost absurdity. What's Murphy going to do next? I made a joke, you know, there's all these guys being, you know, dragged out of bars in New York, you know, passed out in New York. Why are so many guys passing out in New York? Well, they ordered a Daniel Murphy is what they did. What's that? Six consecutive shots, you know, that this is what's happening in New York. So, you know, interesting. Murphy passed out. There you go. Another thing, connection, the accident. So the severe crash. I mean, what did I, when I left this beautiful, beautiful resort-like place, what did I experience? A severe crash. Okay. Severe crash, and Murphy passed out, and people yelling, Murphy, Murphy, Murphy. It's a funny thing. In baseball parlance, you would say them. They say, Murphy, how you doing? They say, oh, he's just unconscious. You know, this is what they say in baseball. Some guy just is like red hot like this. They say he's just unconscious. Well, Murphy's really unconscious right now to the extent that nobody has ever seen. I cannot explain it. I don't think anybody can. He can't explain it. He says, I don't know. The ball just keeps going over the wall. I can't explain it. So he's unconscious. We say, this guy's just completely unconscious. Well, in that accident, in that crash, in the terrible accident, there was a Murphy who was completely unconscious. He was lying there completely unconscious. Murphy unconscious. In a parallel right now, the Mets, Daniel Murphy, completely unconscious, the way he's hitting the baseball. He's not thinking at all. I don't know what he's doing. It just doesn't happen. Against the best pitchers in baseball, you know, it just doesn't happen. So, yeah, you know, let it keep happening. Go for it. Just keep hitting them. You know, everybody's just enjoying the ride here. But, so we have this fulfillment of prophecy, personal prophecy here. We have a fulfillment of it. And then you have this man coming out of the blue, just talking about all this stuff. Wow. And he says, people have no idea what's going on. And he says that these gangs are spreading all over San Jose now. There's pockets of them. He says, right, you see right where we're standing? He says, half a mile down the road here. It's maybe, you know, half a mile down the road. He says, there's this new pocket of gangsters. And this, right in this town that you're in. And this whole area now has become this nest of gang activity. And this is how they work. They're spreading and spreading and spreading. And they just, you know, break into homes. And in broad daylight, he says, burglaries never take place at night anymore. It's always the middle of the day because that's when people are working. Most families now have both spouses working, right? So and the kids are at school, nobody's at home. They just walk right up, break in, take the jewelry and rifle the house and then leave. And this is what is happening all over. And then I have this very affluent person I know in this affluent area, and they're all terrorized by these gangs because the police presence was cut in half, and they don't respond anymore to anything other than life-threatening situations. So if you just call them up and say, hey, there's a burglar, they don't even come out. So the gangsters just go out there all day long. They're breaking into homes. You know, and this is the last place you think this would happen. This is upper middle class, beautiful, affluent area. And, you know, we think that we're somehow immune from this. People in the United States who live in nice areas. And in our town, that's also happening. That's also happening. I have friends I know. The houses on either side of them were broken in broad daylight, and then one right close also. Yeah. And he explained why and what's going on. And it's not something that is remotely going to go away. It's going to get much, much worse. Something I predicted 35 years ago. I said, you know, if you cannot allow a culture to be flooded with certain types of people who cannot properly keep up the level of the culture, you know, great civility, great honor, you know, the whole thing of high civilization is everybody's on the honor system, you know, and it's wonderful. And you cannot allow some people who have a completely different structure, society of just total survival, take whatever you can get you know, and just seize upon anything, and you and are not educated and cannot assimilate properly into the system, you cannot just be flooded, allow that situation to be flooded by that. That is like sheer insanity. It's suicide, you know, cultural suicide, actually. And boy, are we paying the price right now, and it's going to get way, way worse. Now, what does this have to do with spiritual truth? A lot, a lot. Because this is the narrative that I've been given is an end time narrative, and we're told that this world is going to become very, very bad, very problematical. I'm not following the migrant, it's not migrant, sorry, the refugee crisis in Europe at all. I just got a little snippet of it today that says that they're just entering whatever they can, any empty buildings, apartments they can find, they're just going into squatters inside. This is where we're going to live. This is a recipe for disaster. And it tears society down. It tears society down. What happens when that? People turn to drugs. Okay? In order to stay away from drugs, you have to have a high spiritual society. Okay? Like I said, when I grew up, people all in this country, parents didn't worry about their kids at all. Where they were, what they were doing, whatever. Because everyone was looking out for them. And you could go to any house at all, and you were welcome. And you'd be taken care of. And you know, it's like a small town, kind of friendly atmosphere that sort of permeated the country. And someone was just talking about that, how it all changed so suddenly. And it's crazy, you know, the people's paranoia. This is growing, this whole paranoia, this whole fear paranoia, it leads to drugs, it leads to drugs. And the pharmaceutical companies and the corporations, it leads to also excessive materialism of craving some sort of, you know, materialistic comfort. Something to make me feel better. I feel so fearful and jittery and everything. Let me just buy something, and something new, something fresh, something that seems that it's untouched by the corruption, you know. As society decays and corrupts, we keep wanting to buy new things and take medications, take drugs to try to make us feel better. This is the end time. This is a breakdown of trust. Now, people ask me, what's non-dual? I tell you, there's a lot of ways to talk about it, but one great way to talk about it is basically it boils down the non-dual teaching, the non-dual path. If you say I'm really following the non-dual way, what is it? What is the way? What is it? Well, it means having tremendous faith in the great teachers, great spiritual mentors, having tremendous faith in them. This is what it is. Without this tremendous faith, you're going to fall deep, 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 deep into a pit, dark pit. It's the tremendous faith that what they're saying is true, even in the face of all this false evidence. You say, no, I know what they're saying is true, but I cannot square up what I'm experiencing here with that, but I know this must be false in some way. It can't be true. It can't be real. It can't be true. So I'm going to trust them, what they're saying, and I'm going to continually get familiar with what they say. This is the path, familiarity with what the great, great sages tell us. This is the non-dual path, actually. Without that faith, the path is impossible. And I'm just fortunate enough, I have always had this great faith. From the day I was born, I was always focused on great saints. And I said, they're telling the truth. The rest of this nonsense in this world are liars. You know, it's absolute lie. And no matter what anyone said, I've continued to believe in these great sages and continued to pay attention to them my whole life. This is what's required. This is the non-dual path. So I'm not surprised at all that I'm able to get clear on a lot of areas, which continues. The popcorn keeps popping. Today, another day of tremendous clarity, and I'm just kind of just, okay, wow, great. I'm succeeding. I can succeed. I will succeed. I've already succeeded. It's a done deal. It's a done deal. And just feel that, wow, it's a done deal. You know, this wow path is the way. It actually is the way. And it's going to take me all the way. This is a very easy way to get into the wow. Just say, wow, this wow practice is really wow. It works. Wow, this works. And I'm going to be liberated. This will immediately put you into the wow. So by getting familiar with these great sages through tremendous faith, this is the stream, the non-dual stream, the non-dual river that carries us towards being liberated from misery, actually. Terrible misery. It takes great patience, and you get an insight, and then you just have to say, okay, you know what? I'm capable of seeing this insight. I'm going to say, I saw the insight. All right. I saw it. I'm seeing it, and I will continue to see it. Child said, there's another threefold practice. I saw it. I am seeing it. I will continue to see it. I will always see it. I saw it. I'm seeing it. I will always see it. That's like saying, I can, I will, I've already done it. But so an insight, I saw it, I am seeing it, I will always see it. I saw it, I recognized it, I am recognizing it, I will always recognize it. I was aware of it, I am aware of it, I'll always be aware of this. This was helpful, this is helpful, this always will be helpful. So try using that when you have an insight, instead of struggling with what are people's reactions, what are they, how can I explain it to them, all this. Instead, practice. The world is a very tricky place. The belief system that we're projecting, that we call a world, it's really just a belief system that we're projecting. That's all it is. It's very, very devious and tricky. And what it does is it takes consistency as somehow meaning good advice. In other words, it consistently gives us the opposite advice of what we should do. Terrible advice. And then it claims, well, I'm giving you good advice. And why? Well, I'm consistent. That's what you were looking for, consistency in advice. I say, well, I'm looking for two things in advice. Consistency in right advice. Consistently right advice is what we're looking for. Not just consistent advice. So the ego is like a machine. That whatever you, Holy Spirit, says is true, the ego opposes it, goes opposite of it. Is that intelligence or is that like a machine? I don't think that's intelligence at all, is it? It's just contrariness. Contrariness is easy. There's no thinking, there's no insight at all. It's just whatever is true, you just go against it. It's just a go against it-ism. That's not good advice to get free of go against it-ism. So we have, this is the day, this is the kind of days that keep your grace flowing. Now, I realized today that I've never had an experience. There's only experiencing. There's no such thing as an experience. How can we experience? Experience means that something, right? There are no things. How can we experience? If there's no things, how can we experience? How can we have an experience? How can we have an experience? Based on what? What we're really doing is we're experiencing. The flow of experiencing. We're not having an experience. It's impossible. And this ego keeps saying that's having all these experiences. It's not having any experience at all. It's without any experience. And this is why it's so freaked out. But what we really are is experiencing. There isn't any world, there isn't anything, there's no time, space, process, or form at all to experience. You can't experience this. So I say, wow, I've seen this. Wow, I'm seeing it. Wow, I'll always see this. Instead of struggling with this, just say, wow, I've seen this now. Wow, I'm seeing it right now. Wow, I'm always going to be able to see this. I'll always see this. I'll always be clear about this. Wow, I was just clear about this. I'm clear about it now. I'll always be clear about this. Try to practice like this. The real path is practicing. Practicing. Look at any teacher, you name it. Look, start out with Buddha. What's our spiritual heritage? Well, the non-dual spiritual heritage. You can start out, you go way back to the Vedic Rishis, pre-Buddhic time. There's a Vedic Rishis. Okay, you can do that. We can do that. Then you can say Buddha. Okay. Absolutely you can. And then you can fast forward a bit to you flash forward to Jesus Christ, which is 5 BC. Then you go to the 7th, 8th century AD, maybe you call it the 8th century AD, but Shankara, Adi Shankara. Okay, fabulous non-dual teacher. I just came stumbling across a blog by somebody that had all these great teachings by Shankara. And I've studied Shankara before when I was younger, crest jewel of discrimination or something, the crown jewel, was it Christopher Isherwood or something? I mean, Shankara was very much hip for a while there. But in reacquainting myself with Shankara, reading all this stuff, it was just astonishing, you know. But I understood it. I said, "Yeah, this is exactly true." Oh my gosh, Shankara is a great, great, great teacher, one of the top sages in history, without any question about it. Adi Shankara. Then you can go to, if you'd like to, you go to Longchenpa. Yeah, Longchenpa. A great Dzogchen, Tibetan Buddhist Dzogchen master. Another absolute titan of non-dual recognition. Fabulous, fabulous sage. And this is about, what, 1340 something, or I don't know, somewhere around there. So we go from Buddha to Jesus to Shankara to Longchenpa. We'll jump forward again. Who do we go to? Well, why not? We go to Ramana Maharshi. What, late 18, what was the 1870s or something, maybe 1880 born, maybe, yeah. Fabulous. We know Ramana Maharshi, how absolutely fabulous, how absolutely perfectly non-dual Ramana Maharshi was. Perfect jewel. Perfect jewel. Then we can go to 1896, Ananda Mayama. Okay, another absolute perfect sage, perfect non-dualist. And finally, we can go to 1965, October 21st, 1965, A Course in Miracles. Jesus, once again, with A Course in Miracles. Absolutely brilliant non-dual teaching. Now, if you look in history, you have to say like the last 100 years, 100 plus years, let's say, with Ramana Maharshi passing away in 1950, not in my 1982. So you take 1950, well, less than 100 years, 1950 to 1965. I mean, right in that period, we had Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Mayama, A Course in Miracles. Three of the best non-dual teachers in the history of this planet were here within a window of 15 years, actually. Okay, get this through our minds. This is really important. Ramana passed away in 1950. So if he was here in 1950, and A Course in Miracles came in 1965, we can say, just to round off, so to speak, 15 years. And then, of course, Ananda Mayama was here and going strong at that time, okay? Not to mention Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj, who's not, you know, who's a great non-dual teacher, but not quite the like one of the cornerstones, you would say, you know, historical cornerstones. But he was also here, and there are others. Some would say also they can name him, but we're talking about some of, you know, let's just name the huge towering colossuses, you know, up on Mount Rushmore of some spiritual non-dual teachers. Well, here's some of them. Three of them were here in a 15-year window. Three of them are here in a 15-year window, right in the 20th century. Now, I just miss Ramana Maharshi, unfortunately. But his potency is still very strong. I was born 6 years after he passed away. So in a 15-year period, we had three of the greatest teachers in the history of this planet giving us the greatest teaching ever, you know. Is this not astonishing? Now, when you go back and look at Buddha, was what, like 5th century B.C., something like that, 5th century B.C., we'll call it. And that's 500 years to Jesus, and then 700 years or so to Adi Shankara, and then another 600, 700 years to Longchenpa, and then, what, 1300s tonight, another 600 years to the 19th century. So there's these like long steps between these great teachers. I know there's lots of other teachers along the way, but we're just for the sake of looking at this. And then in a 15-year period, we have three of the best teachers in history all here. Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Mayama, Jesus Christ. How, you know, how extraordinary is that? And how does that speak to what we're talking about here? This must be a crisis in this planet. There must be a severe crisis here. Because they come to help us avoid a massacre, is not in my mind, I would say. He says, why should we do practice? He says, why should you avoid a massacre? You know. So, for this to happen, they must be saying, hey, you know, you got to get with it. This is a big push we're having here. And when you find out what's really happening behind the facade, the corporate facade, that, hey, everybody, everything's great, just buy, work, 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 progress. You know, behind the glossing over of everything, the lipstick on the pig, is this rot that's taking place. Just like Andrew Jackson looks so wonderful in the $20 bill, you see a picture of him, he looks like he's rotted. Terrible. I said, my God, I'm shocked seeing this picture. You got to be kidding me. I said, that can't possibly be him. This is the country. What the Holy Spirit's telling me, this country is rotted. It's like rotted like Andrew Jackson. And then at the end of our talk, the man wanted to give me the $20. He said, thank you so much for listening to me and everything. This has been a really great conversation. He says, here, take it. I said, no. No, thank you. Thank you for the information. And we all thank you. You know, we all thank you for helping us with this information, actually. He's done a service to the whole planet. Coming forward, he's, you know. So, people, you know, just coming forward to me and talking. It probably is because they know I understand what they're saying and won't judge them, and I get it, you know. Somehow they're so spiritual, you know, the mind's all one somehow. So, this happened today. So this should give us all, like, wow. Wow. And then this Murphy thing, okay. Three great teachers here in a window of 15 years. All of them completely immaculate, you know, completely immaculate. All of them in this unsurpassable condition, you know. The teachers I mentioned, they're all, you know, unsurpassable because they're perfect. Perfect teachers and perfect realization. All six of these teachers: Buddha, Jesus, Jesus one, and then Adi Shankara, Longchenpa. Is that seven teachers? Buddha, Jesus, Shankara, Longchenpa, Ram Maharshi, Nandamayama, and A Course in Miracles. Jesus. That's seven. Okay, seven great teachers there. And we'll count Jesus twice because he brought in this A Course in Miracles, which is just an enormous help. An enormous non-dual help. It's something that was needed because of the rot of the times that is coming, that has happened. Now, I have first-hand account of a man living in that zone, and he tells me what it's like. He says, you know, it used to be a nice neighborhood. Now it's like a combat zone. He said, like, it's a war zone. Oh, the prison man told me that there's been 200 murders in San Jose. He says, you don't know about it. He says, there's a lot of stuff you don't know is going on. Of course, they want people to keep coming there and investing, and, you know, so he says, it's way worse than people realize what's going on. Yeah. Believe it. He had no reason to, you know, tell me different. He's just an honest guy. He says, I work there. This is what I do. I know. Now, how do we put all this all together? This thing. Now, in this terrible crash that I came across, what happened? I went back to this beautiful resort area and just hung out there and ate good food and relaxed in this great beauty and calmed down. I was able to calm my nerves down, which were just intensely disturbed by this terrible crash. So this also is telling us something, that somehow we're going to back away from the rot that's happening here, the horrible rot. We don't realize how bad it's affecting us until we get out of it. It's like this, it's like a terrible crash is happening, and you're coming across this terrible accident, and you're so upset by it, and you're dealing with it, right? And you say, I just got to function, I was just functioning. But once you then back away from it, then that's when you realize your whole body's shaking and trembling. And you say, wow, it affected me way worse than I thought. When you're in shock, and you know, you don't really feel shock, you feel it later on. So I would say that this world is shocking us, actually. It's very shocking, and it is. It absolutely shocks me what's going on in this world. I cannot, there's not anything like a world that I would want, you know, to be in. Absolutely not. It's the opposite. It's the opposite. I hate it. Absolutely hate what's going on here. Through and through and through and through and through. My gosh. So, what is this backing, going back to where we came from? Going back to where we came from. What does that mean? This is yet the puzzle, piece of the puzzle that has to be solved. And we'll see what comes up about this. We'll see what comes up about this. Going back to what we're used to. Going back to where we came from, where it's really nice. Let's go back to where we came from. It's really nice. This place here is headed for troubles. Now, United Nations are fiddling around again about Rome burns. And, you know, the thing about the environment, it's very complex, but we don't know exactly what's going to happen. But the bets are it's not going to be very good, okay? It's not like it's going to get better and better and better. It's like, oh, wow, conditions are getting better and better and better here. Everything is so much nicer. So, I mean, it's not, I don't think that's what's going to happen here. It's likely that it's going to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. People running out of food. Now, we know in certain areas it's likely that, you know, massive droughts can happen and that people run out of food. What happens then? Guess what? Europe has just shown us what happens when people, especially third world people, they're very resourceful. Have a lot of love and respect for third world people. They're very aware, they're very resourceful, they're survivalists. And they're going to survive. What are they going to do? They're going to come right into your town. They're going to come right into your country, your town, in your face. Give me food, give me lodging, give me, give me, give me. We're talking, you know, there could be, you know, just constant mass migrations into the developed wealthy countries, just absolutely flooding them with ultimately crime and strife and turmoil and just hellish conditions, actually. We may say, well, you know, climate change is not bothering us here in the United States. Actually, it's going to help out Canada and, you know, upper areas of Russia and various areas that are cold now. It's going to warm up and it's going to help them greatly economically. So, you know, I actually enjoy a warmer planet. I enjoy heat. So I hate the cold. So I say, wow, plants warming up, how nice. But it's not so nice for those people who live in the real hot zones of the world. Those people could face devastating problems. And they most certainly, now with the transportation we have in this world, they're going to find a way to come into your country, for sure, for sure. And, you know, won't have jobs for them. They're just going to say, hey, give us food. Give us everything. You know, give, give, give. And so there's only so many that can be absorbed. This is a nightmare waiting to happen. Now we have a severe drought in California. We have so many people in California. I don't know how many it is. Now, was it 38 million or something? I mean, we should have like 12. This is about the water can pretty much handle in California. I would say about a third. Three times too many people in California. They just let everyone flood into California. You know, oh, yeah, this is crazy. And again, 35 years ago, and 30 years, and 25, I said this policy of California is crazy, absolutely insane. And it, of course, is driven by big corporations and the Democrats have controlled Congress for a long they've always controlled Congress, it seems like, in California, and they've controlled the politics, and you know, they were heavily into the lobbyists of the big ag corporations, et cetera, et cetera. And they allowed to have this lax policy here, and now there's this insane number of people in California, and there's no water. If we had like 12 million people and foresight, we would have had, still have water in the reservoirs. You know, we'd be able to get through these droughts. Okay, now if we don't get rain this year, you know, going forward, this is a complete catastrophe. The Californians will be migrating to where you live, as a matter of fact. We won't have any water here to I mean, I guess you can buy bottled water, but, you know, how do you, good luck flushing the toilets. I don't know what they're going to do. Maybe just going to dig a pit in the backyard. It's, you know, so... The planet, yeah, it's got a lot of problems. It's the end times, the tribulation time. It's a time of, as they said in the Bible, time of severe droughts, severe famines, severe plagues. One of those plagues is mass refugees, okay? Severe strife, severe conflict, you know, epidemics, you name it. You name it. And these flooding with third world peoples, they bring a lot of different illnesses, diseases, and troubles. It's a whole different vibrational pattern and way of life, etc. You know, it's like oil and water. It doesn't mix very well. And the high culture comes crashing down. You're not able to maintain high focus, which enables you to even to recognize, have tremendous faith. The purpose of a high civilization is it's built on tremendous faith in these great sages. That's what high civilization is built upon. When you let go of that, your society and civilization is going to crash and decay into, you know, like, you look like, civilization will look like a meth addict. You know, you've seen those pictures before and after of meth addicts. Well, global civilization will look as if it was a meth addict. You know, and that is really a scary, scary picture. Andrew Jackson looked like a meth addict the way he looked. Well, the whole planet's going to look like a meth addict. Because you lose, the great civilizations have always been built up upon tremendous faith in certain sages, okay? This is how it is. And to not realize this is planetary suicide. So the United Nations is off their rocker, because they don't base it on tremendous faith in actually, they have tremendous faith in extraterrestrials is what they really have. And so that's what they're putting their faith in. But these extraterrestrials are not great sages. You know, they're not. They love the praise they get here by, you know, this world's, oh, you're so smart. Oh, yes, you can help us with bioengineering and doing this, genetic engineering. Oh, this is wonderful. You're so smart. And they kind of like that, you know. It's like we have a dog. The dog likes us. And we say, oh, I really like the fact the dog likes me. They're like that. But these are not sages. These extraterrestrials are not enlightened sages. They're not enlightened non-dual sages. Not at all. Not in any way are they this way. They don't really know what they're talking about. So, we, great civilization here on this planet is based on, for instance, look what Buddha did. Look what Buddha did, is still doing. Look what Jesus Christ did, is still doing. Look what Adi Shankar did, is still doing. Okay, look at Longchenpa did, still doing, right? The influence is still profound. Look at Ramana Maharshi's profound influence. Look at Sri Sri Nanamama, profound influence. Look at A Course in Miracles having a profound influence. This is what builds up high civilization, is you have this tremendous faith in what the sages say. And you order your life that way. Your belief system becomes that way. You become very spiritualized in a proper way. My gosh, America, you know, the high Christianity that America had at some point was, you know, people were so nice and kind and decent and trustworthy. I mean, it was just quite extraordinary. Very forgiving, very compassionate. This American culture has contributed so much more donations to the rest of the world than the whole world put together, I would say. I mean, they're just extraordinarily giving, helping. But of course, they want to. They believe that's they need to do that to get to heaven. and that's not really non-dual teaching at all. You don't need to do anything. You're already there. This is something, you see, those who feel they need to do something can never get the fact that they're already there. It doesn't compute. And so dualism is a belief to say that you need to do something to be where you already are, to get to where you already are. This is obviously a ridiculous statement, that I need to do something to be where I really am. I'm already where I am. I don't need to do anything at all. I'm immersed in the oneness. All is immersed in the one. Everything is already immersed in the oneness. There's nothing that anything has to do or accomplish. Nothing that anything needs to accomplish. That tree doesn't need to accomplish anything to be immersed in the oneness. This grass doesn't need to do anything to be immersed in the oneness. Everything is already completely free. Everything is already eternal life. Everything is completely free of all obligations, all necessity, all need. 100% free. It is just an expression, an appearancing that's happening. There's nothing else going on at all. We're just superimposing a belief system upon it all. And the only reason I can talk like this is because of these great teachers, these seven great sages, I would call the seven great sages. And Buddha, Jesus, Shankara, Longchenpa, Ramaharshi, Nanda Maimon, and Jesus again. Course in Miracles. Jesus, we would call it. Jesus 2.0. Buddha, Jesus, Shankara, Longchenpa, Ramaharshi, Nanda Maimon, Jesus 2.0, Course in Miracles, ACIM. The only way I can talk is like that is because of them. Is because of them. All of them. All of them have contributed to the high spiritual culture of this planet. All of them have made great, great, great contributions, actually. And so we stand on their shoulders. It's not just one of them, you know, it's all of them. These are great non-dual sages. Okay, now there's other religious leaders, you know. This is different. We're talking about non-dual sages. You listen to Adi Shankara and him talk, and it is so extraordinary. I mean, you talk about someone who just is straightforward. Wow. That's a non-dual sage, Adi Shankara. Just dig into that a little bit. Maybe, I don't know. I'll put some resources down beneath the video in the summary of the video area. Maybe some links, you know, to go check out some of the stuff I'm talking about. Maybe this blog, maybe you can go just look, read it, you know. I mean, it's extraordinary. The stuff that I come across now is just extraordinary. This is complete happenstance. I don't even know how I got there, actually. Yeah, this is the way it is surfing on the internet, right? Sometimes, you know, I have no idea how you got somewhere, but there you are. And this is his best blog I've ever read. It's no longer, he's not posting anymore. Stopped in 2014, but the posts are just scintillating with non-dual truth. Scintillating. Now, he has his point of view, but you can sift through that and get the gist of it all. So familiarity wins. Familiarity wins. We go back to what we're familiar with. When push comes to shove, it's what we're familiar with. That is where we will abide. That's what we'll abide. So we have to keep saying, hey, the tree's already abiding. It doesn't need to do anything. Nothing needs to do anything. How about that? Nothing needs to do anything. It's everything is already abiding, and this will always be the case. So everything is born already liberated in the now, as Longchenpa would put it. Everything arises already liberated in the now. This is absolutely true. Again, Longchenpa is an absolutely fabulous, perfect non-dual teacher. So we've had these teachers in the world, you know, and you know, people are ignoring them. You cannot ignore these teachers like this, great new non-dual teachers, because only they tend to inspire this tremendous faith that we need. We need tremendous faith to pull ourselves through this continuity fear problem we have. Tremendous faith. The continuity fear is so severe, anything less than tremendous faith, it won't work. It's not enough. You just spin your wheels. You get caught up in an egoic trap and just spin your wheels. Happens. The wheel spinning happens all the time. You stall out. So you have to have this tremendous faith. This has to come from perfect non-dual teachers. Great, great, perfect non-dual teachers. This is what inspires this great faith. So a world without this, a culture that ignores this, is a culture that is going to end up in gangster land. And these gangsters spend all their time, again, giggling and laughing and boasting about all their crimes. They're not repentant. They think it's great. There's something to boast about. So don't think that living in gangsterland is something chic. It's the opposite. It's hideous. Just take it from my friend who says, He says, I can't even bear living there anymore. I just can't bear it. It's so terrible. It's ruined my life. I'm just in such a terrible attitude and mood now. I don't want to have kids. I can't possibly raise them. He said, this is just a nightmare. I got to get out. Fortunately, he's getting out. How about that? Hallelujah. He deserves it. We all deserve it. None of us deserve to live in gangster land. Not even the gangsters. They're just suffering from extreme continuity fear, which is why they're down in this low, you know, gangster landness. And again, I'll tell you this. As tough as these gangsters are right here in San Jose, they're terrified of the gangsters down in Central America coming up here. They're terrified of them. They're, you know, way worse. The world has just this extraordinary issues because of the lack of faith in the great sages. Now, this is important. I have the seven great sages here, let's say. And of course, I'm using ACM as if it were a great sage. It comes from Jesus, actually. But let's say seven great sages. Now, the ego is always frantically trying to undermine these truth. So, lately it's open season on Jesus, and everyone is going after him. The ego's going after him. The media is going after him, trying to completely change what he really is and give a false image to the world about Jesus. Not that Christians, many of them haven't done that already, but at least some of the truth got through. There's forgiveness, and a lot of things got through, but they're still very dualistic. But the media is just trying to run him down into just either he never existed, or he was just this regular rabbi, or everything was embellished, or he was just a social worker, or, you know, he was a revolutionary, he wanted to drive the Romans out, and all this nonsense, pablum, you know, idiot, pablum. And so the Jesus is under unprecedented attack. What he really is. They're trying to distort it. Well, if this becomes too much of a problem and you need some help, guess what? We have these other six sages. Well, Jesus number two, we have Jesus number two. If they go after Jesus number one, we have Jesus number two, which is, of course, in miracles. Journey Beyond Words, the other voice. These are form the core of A Course in Miracles, really. We have that, which is extraordinary. And we say, hey, wait a minute, this just isn't some revolutionary trying to drive the Romans out because of excessive taxation in Galilee. I mean, this is like a completely perfect non-dual sage here we're listening to. And then if there's a problem with that, you know, people say, well, it's a this or this or this. Well, you got Ramana Maharshi. You got Ramana Maharshi. If they say, we don't like the way he dressed, you know, well, you got Ananda Maima. They say, well, we don't like, she didn't give enough teaching out, or where's her books, or, well, we've got Longchenpa then, okay? They don't like Longchenpa, well, we got Adi Shankara. They don't like that, we got Gautama Buddha. And you can just kind of move around and keep being nourished, because all these are perfect non-dual sages. You don't have to stop. You don't get stuck. Don't get stuck. So I'm not just, I'm not stuck in A Course in Miracles. I'm not stuck there. No. Sometimes there's a lot of effort to distort A Course in Miracles, actually. A lot. Especially the high-profile people, marketing it, etc. There's a tendency to distort it and pull it into a dualistic perspective. Well, this is what happens in the world always. But so, you know, that's okay. You know, this is what happens in the world. And you can look at Ramana Maharshi and just get the silence and you just say, wow, I know this is true. There's no question. And then you can keep on track with the non-dual message. Keep on track with it. So there is a way to stay on track. You have to really work at it. And be flexible. Be calm. Be flexible. Be calm. Be flexible. Be calm. Be flexible. It takes tremendous faith, but the faith is well placed in these great teachers. It's well placed. I've been able to verify what they've said in glimpses and moments, etc. I've been able to verify it. Saying they're telling the truth. They're telling the truth. Now the ego just has, we have so many tricks up our sleeve because of continuity fear, because of wanting to honor time. And then because of continuity fear, we then go into worshiping time. See, we have this idea of time, which can't exist and doesn't exist in reality at all. There's no such thing as time. There's no thingness. There's no bondage. There's no two moments bound together. So how can there be things? How can there be time? There isn't. And how can there be distance? We can experience whatever we want to right now, right here, right now. There's no notion of distance like we have space, you know. So time and space are just something we imagined. And same with process. There's no process of getting somewhere or getting something. None whatsoever. Whatever we want to experience is right here, right now, and are experiencing in reality. And no things, time, space, process, and form. There's no form in reality at all. It's all formless. So formless ideation and experiencing essence. And so we had this idea of time, space, process, and form to try and really trick God. You know, we wanted to trick God into saying, hey, this is your creation. This is what you created, time, space, process, and form, and not reality. But it had no flow to experience. I mean, it was just like a blip, and then it was gone like that. Because everything is, there is no time, space, process, and form. So obviously this notion that there is only instantaneous right here, right now, not changing reality in the slightest bit. And so it's like I said, it's a stillbirth. I mean, it doesn't go anywhere at all. So it lasted just an instant, Jesus said. But because it seemed like it didn't go anywhere, we were hoping that it would go somewhere, you know, in the flow, it would flow somehow. It didn't flow in the way we thought it might. We wanted to then honor this idea, this stillborn idea. So our creativity, we used our creativity to honor it. And so we imagined all of this existence. But the problem is then, when we want to stop honoring it, we have a continuity problem. Because we think, oh, wait a minute, how do we get back to reality? What do you mean back? See, we think we're in time, space, process, and form. Because we've been believing in this. So we think, well, there's a distance, there's a time, it takes a time to reach, go back home, has to take time, has to be distant, it has to be a process, it has to have some format and form to it. And we don't realize, no, we're right here, right now. We're home. Everything's home. There's no place but home. And so this frightens us. We're afraid like of the immediacy of it. So there's a severe continuity fear. So what happens is we start worshiping time instead of honoring it. It's different story. Start worshiping it. This is where the problems really arise. So what we need to do is shift from time worshiping to time honoring. And time to do this, you need great faith in these sages. This is the necessary shift. That's the shift I was able to take. And I said, Jesus, I know that A Course in Miracles, I said, I know this is true. It's right on the mark. No question about it. And I don't care whatever comes up to dispute it. It's false, you know. It's just this clever plausibility, you know. This very clever plausibility, but it's false. So it's just a matter of then evaporating the continuity fear, continually working to evaporate it. But this is what's necessary to shift from time worshiping to time honoring, and get it back to time honoring. And from there, you can be told, oh yeah, okay, I admit I'm just honoring time. See, you're honest at that point. You're not worshiping time, saying, time, I want you to be real. I want you to be real. I know you're real. You got to be real. If I keep worshiping you, you're going to become real. You know, this is time worshiping. Whereas time honoring says, time, I know you were kind of just like instant. And I'm just honoring you with my creativity. But I know that's all it is. You can never become real. But I also know I have a continuity fear. So then I just need to work on evaporating it. And it's very simple. It's just, that's the spiritual path. It's just like that. In a different boat, when you repent, you make this shift from time worshiping to time honoring. There's a great way to describe repentance, is to go from time worshiping to time honoring. How do we do it? Tremendous faith in these great sages. And of course, we include the Holy Spirit in that, which is really the heart of it all, right? The heart of it all, because all these sages come out of the activity of the Holy Spirit, actually. This is the expression, activity expression, but there's a good way to relate to it is these great sages, because they came here and you know, walked the walk here and helped us have faith. So ultimately it's faith in the Holy Spirit, you could say, which is ultimately faith in ourselves, what we truly are. But this is repentance, is go from time worshiping to honoring time, from worshiping time to honoring time. This is repentance. Once you repent, you will know that you're on the right track, because you'll know it's just a matter of this continuity fear, very severe fear, but it's, you can do it a little bit at a time. You can gradually evaporate this fear, because you know you're already, you know, everywhere is home. There's only home. There's nothing that anything needs to do to get home. It's impossible to leave home. So we lift this burden off of the world. There's some sort of, you know, projected burden we put on the world, that everything is involved in some time, space, process, and form, some purpose, and it needs to accomplish something, you know, nature needs to accomplish. There's no such thing like that. There's nothing that nature needs to accomplish. There's nothing that anything, any accomplishment, is, none of that is needed in order to be home, where everything is intrinsically home. Everything is intrinsically home. Without any effort, it can never leave home. There's no effort, no effortness. You know, this whole, it doesn't mean that we cannot flow in experiencing, of course. But there's not this feeling of, first I have to make an effort in order to have experiencing. It's not like that at all. Experiencing is not based on having to do something first to get home. So we don't experience getting home, we just experience home. And repentant mind can accept this. A non-repentant mind cannot accept it. They say, no. I mean, they're worshiping time, so they have to believe first you have to do something. Right? There has to be time, space, process, and form. There has to be some distance to it. There has to be some process. So they cannot relate to this non-dual teaching. Worshipping time cannot relate to non-dual teaching, cannot take the path. Only the repentant can take this path. Only the repentant can take this path. And there's this little bug jumping all over my face. Come on, little bug, don't go in my eye. So great, wow, say, wow, I really am on the path. And just realize this. If you have tremendous faith in the, you know, great sage, you're on the path. You know, you're on the path. You have some sort of inner knowing that you know you're going to succeed. It's just, you know, if for some reason it seems to take time. Well, we're still, you know, honoring time. And the continuity fear slows us down. So it seems to take a while. You have to be very patient. So we're shifting gears all the way. It's like driving through Silicon Valley. You go this way, you go that way, you speed up, you slow down. I mean, it's just going through traffic, but this is this heavy traffic right now. This is what is happening in the world. You got to go through, drive through heavy traffic right now, very heavy traffic. So the high culture is collapsing everywhere. So in that experience I had with the accident, I was in a place that was like, it's very conducive to super high culture and non-dual contemplation. Saw a terrible accident, terrible crash, and went back to that place again. Said, wow, just got to hang out here and regain my clarity and calm and all that. So this is what the Holy Spirit's indicated is going to happen. So we'll just say, okay, it's going to happen. It's already happened. If the Holy Spirit says happened, it means it's already happened. See, in the Holy Spirit, there's no time, space, process, form in terms of having to do something first. When whatever the Holy Spirit decrees, decides this is going to happen, this is what happened. It's already happened. Time is really an illusion. It's all, everything has already happened in terms of the Holy Spirit helping us with our continuity fear. So it says that you're going to go to back to a place where you can, you know, regain your clarity, non-dual clarity. Okay. This means it's already happened. We don't need to worry about what's going to happen, whatever, or what are the details. Just say, this can happen, this will happen, this has already happened. This can happen, it will happen, this has already happened. It's already happened. And then feel that. That it's not in danger of not happening. There's no danger of it not happening whatsoever. Just like there's no danger of us not being home. There's no danger of that whatsoever. There's no danger of anything not being home. Zero danger in that. So this whole endangerment thing that we're feeling, it's all about the feeling that we're in danger of not finding our way home. It's impossible. If we don't find our way home, we're in no endangerment of actually leaving home. To say that we're finding our way home is completely dualistic, actually. Now, so the great sages sometimes talk that way. Like Adi Shankara says, hey, look, I talk to people. Some people are so full of continuity fear that, I need to talk to them a certain way. Otherwise, they'll be too scared. So I might say we need to find a path home. You know, it helps them get going. But then to those who have the ears to hear me, and then I talk in it, I make it clear you never left home. There's no path. As Krishnamurti said, truth is a pathless land. There's no path. To truth. There's no path to truth. The truth is that everything is intrinsically home. It's always been. There's never been an instant when it wasn't home. There's never been one instant, never will be, where everything is not perfectly at home. Everything is already, has always been. Everything's always been, is now, and always will be perfectly at home. There's no danger. There's no endangerment of anything in that regard at all. So we keep listening to these great sages, and it's slow to sink in because of continuity fear. You know, it's only gradually we get familiar with it. It's like frostbite, it takes a while to thaw out. Don't want to go too fast, maybe we'll be hurt too much. So we tend to go, kind of bit by bit, gradually back away from madness, back away from, the dance of continuity fear. And in the world, I say it's getting worse. It's just what's happening is intentional. We've gone on over and over and over and over this again. And ultimately, they want to reach an authoritarian society under dictatorship so that they can control everything. And they want to break it down so bad that people decide that they want that. But of course, if you're in a small town, everything's wonderful, friendly people, you don't need authoritarian structure at all, right? So they're trying to terrorize everyone through these gangsters and drugs and various, economic situations, etc. So we all think, oh my gosh, we're so in danger, there's so much endangerment. And that then lends itself to a dualistic belief system, which ends up being a very nasty situation. But we're endangered. Well, dualism helps us realize that there's no such thing as endangerment, actually. From a spiritual standpoint, nothing can leave home. The ultimate endangerment we fear is, how do we get back home? Oh, there's gangsters in my way. How do I get back home? There's nothing in a way. We're already home. And that changes our outlook, on everything. Even gangsters then are all beautiful people. People are on edge. They really are on edge because of this all, socially engineered. All this is social engineering. To There's someone who has a solution and they're looking for a problem to apply it to. So they're manufacturing a problem. They can come in and say, hey, guess what? We need to take over. Any day I expect the Pope to say, well, hey, guess what? There are extraterrestrials. We've been in contact with them for quite some time. We weren't quite ready to tell the world, but we're telling them now. And these extraterrestrials were sent by Jesus Christ to help solve the problems of the planet. And we all need to follow their guidance now. Any day, right? It's coming very soon. And extreme dualism, the teachings, all that stuff. And this lends itself, this is, you know, to the feeling of endangerment, which feeling of that I need protection, a feeling of protection, of a projecting threat, fear, all the troubles we have. But non-dual says, look, everything is intrinsically home. Can never leave it. In its birth, growth, and dissolution, it never leaves home. Even when it dies, it doesn't leave home. There's nowhere but home. There's nowhere but immersion. Everything is just immersion itself. Everything is pure spaciousness itself. Where can pure spaciousness go to die from itself? It cannot. The body arises, sustains, and departs, has no effect at all on pure spaciousness. The feeling of pure spaciousness is not affected in the slightest bit. The feeling of perfect immersion, just immersionness, has no effect on it. Nothing that arises has any effect upon it. So when the body of the sage dies, does that affect how they feel? Not in the slightest bit. It's no more important to them than a, you know, a little a leaf falling off a tree in autumn. Literally, nothing, you know, or anything, you know, pine needle falling off a tree, a flower wilting. A rose wilting on the rose bush. It has no more significance than any of that, and no significance. Because they know it doesn't even create a ripple in pure spaciousness and in pure immersion. Not even the tiniest ripple. Nothing at all happens. They feel exactly the same as always. That's why I say, the great sages were never born, they never were here, they never died. Because what they knew themselves to be pure spaciousness, and that's always everywhere. I say, how can they be here? They say, I'm everywhere. How can I go anywhere? I'm everywhere. How can everywhere go anywhere? So how can I be born? What do you mean? How can I be born? I'm everywhere. How can everywhere be born? How can it grow? How can it die? You know, so they don't identify with the body as having any meaning at all, relative to reality. There's nothing relative to home, to reality. This is what they're trying to get through to us, and I just keep listening, I keep hearing, I keep focusing, keep you know, hearing it, and wow, and just keep doing it. You have to keep doing it. It's quite a message, isn't it? Ram Maharshi, when he was, what, 16, and 16 or 17, just lay down. His dad had just died recently, I think, and he just said, okay, what is this death thing? And he said he experienced the death of his body. And he said, okay, but I still exist completely, perfectly. What? So the death of body didn't do anything to me, to awareness, pure awareness. So the birth didn't do anything. Growth, death, he realized that the cycles of the body, cycles of everything, nature doesn't do anything to what we are, to what reality is. It itself is also reality. Everything is immersed in immersion. Is immersion itself. So we may not realize at this instant, but we get more and more familiar with it. More and more familiar, more and more familiar. Meanwhile, people are watching television, you know. I mean, is that getting them more and more familiar with this content? with the great sages? I don't know. I don't think I've seen the great sages being highlighted on television or in the media or on the internet or any, you know. The internet's the one place, you know, that we have the option. I can do a video like this and post it, right? And you can have the option to watch it. But, you know, program television and movies and stuff, you know, they're being spoon-fed stuff that has nothing to do with these great sages. And so how does that help? We need tremendous faith in them. How does that help our tremendous faith? This is something you have to consider all the time, is my tremendous faith, what I am doing, is that helping my tremendous faith in these great non-dual sages, or is it hurting it? So make sure you keep doing what helps your tremendous faith. Otherwise, you'll slip into time worshiping. There's no question about it. You need to stay in time honoring, which is awareness of continuity fear, and realize, okay, I was just honoring time. That's all this is. That's it. Time can never be real. I accept that, but I also accept that I'm creatively honoring it, and that's okay. But now I've set it down. Oops, I know I have a continuity fear. Okay, let me work at it. So it becomes very pragmatic and not so troublesome. Don't ever argue like who's the best sage or who's the best, that, you know, that's the ego. That's the ego. It's like, who's the best guitar player? As I said, I was watching a YouTube, I saw one of the videos, I was watching a YouTube video by Eddie Van Halen. And I looked at Van Halen, and I suddenly got how he's doing it, I never did before. For so many years, you know, he has just cast a spell on everyone. I just could not, and just in this instant, I suddenly saw, oh my gosh, okay. It's really not what I thought it was, exactly. But he's selling it so good. And he's, you know, it's his attitude. It's the attitude. It's the whole package, you know. Eddie Van Halen's like, it's the whole package that he had. It's not just the guitar playing. It's the whole package. So, this is the way the great stylists are, you know. It's like Jimi Hendrix, okay? I mean, it's the whole package with Jimi Hendrix, right? Eric Clapton, it's the whole package. These great icons, for instance, of you know, electric guitar, rock guitar, you know, what you want to call it. It's the entire package. You know, it's not the nuts and bolts of their technique, of their playing. Anyway, you know, there's lots of talented, technical, great players. But these icons, it's a different story. It's a different story. And Eddie even said, I remember him say it, he said, hey, look, you know, I'm just really good at faking it. He is. He's really good at it. And selling it. Not that he isn't a very good guitar player. He is. Super good guitar player. But he approaches it from a certain angle, you know. And if you see that, I finally saw it. It's hard to explain. I said, oh my gosh, I could have done that. If I had known that's what it is, I could have done that, you know, but I didn't. I thought it was something else. He's not really trying to be a technical virtuoso at all. He's just riffing. He knows how to string it together. He knows how to sell it. He knows how to, you know, it's the whole package. It's like Jimi Hendrix. He wasn't technically that good necessarily, right? I mean, a lot of, you know, there are people who can play a lot like Jimi Hendrix, really. You know, just like there's another Elvis, another icon. You know, a lot of people can sing like Elvis, right? Absolutely. But Elvis was the total package. He was the total package. It was, you know, not just a singing. It was something else. Something else, right? It was Elvis, you know? And, you know, the Beatles were the Beatles. They sold it, you know, it was an attitude, it was everything. And you try to pick it apart, you know, you can't find it, but if you see it's everything, then you can just, so you can, sometimes you might have just a wow, like I have with watching Eddie Van Halen. So they said, wow, the thing about Van Halen is so extraordinary. Like the song, what, Change, for instance, like, No, unchained. I'm sorry, unchained, unchained, unchained. He just hit. He just hits these chords. I mean, he can hit these simple chords that everybody else in the world, any guitar player, can hit the same doggone chords. But nobody sounds as good hitting those chords as Eddie Van Halen. It sounds completely different. How do you explain something like that? It's like a piano player hits a C chord. Every pianist in the world can hit that C chord. But when this piano player comes and hits a C chord, it's like everyone just goes, "Whoa." What was that? What was that? How do you explain this, you see? How is that explainable, really? So Eddie Van Halen hits these chords, you just go, whoa, what's he doing? Well, he's just hitting a chord, But really, is that all he's doing, actually? No, he's saying, this is like the bossest chord you ever heard, He's just saying, this is just gonna flow. It's an attitude, like, here we go. It's like that. We're starting this insane journey. I mean, this is just going to be a journey, man. Here we go. And he's like, whoa, here, what's going to happen? And it's just like, your ears just pick up and you say, whoa. And everybody's trying to figure out, what's Eddie doing? Well, how's he doing a chord? No. It's here we go, folks. With these great non-dual teachers, here we go. Here we go. They have total confidence, in what they're saying. And so someone else can say the same doggone thing, and it's not the same. Someone's going to be silent. It's not the same silence as Ram Maharshi, It's just not. It's just extraordinary. You look at it and say, wow, this is just nothing but wow. This is just total wow. It's only wow. Because why? They know that everything is already home. They're living it. Just like Eddie Van Halen, the star, he knows his boy. Do I have some ear candy for you in this song? Bullet, and he knows it, right? Because he's very, very innovative with sounds and stuff and riffs, and so he already knows. I know this ear candy. I mean, here it comes, folks. Here it comes, and you better listen up. And so you get this feeling from him, like, hey, I better listen up. This is gonna be awesome. I heard on the radio today in a story. I heard this Van Halen. I said, whoa, It's like, oh my gosh, you can just hear, it sounds different. There's that guitar sound. What in the heck? What in the world is this? It just sounds different. It's just something else. There's a style of it. Same with Jimi Hendrix, the style. Still, if you listen to Jimi Hendrix, like All on the Watchtower, for instance, it's just, oh my gosh. Today, how many years has it been since that? What was that, 60, 66 maybe, or 7, along the Watchtower? It had to be in the 60s, right? 45, 46, 47, 48, going towards 50 years, right? And, you just say, this is just completely... Completely. What is this? This is just incredible. And the song just still carries such incredible weight all on the Watchtower. Boom, 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 boom. Boom, 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 boom. Do, 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 do. Anyone can hit those notes, right? But nothing's going to sound like Hendrix playing All on the Watchtower. Just a three-man band, but holy cow. Well, really, Van Halen was not a three-man band. Alex on drums and Mark Anthony on bass and Eddie on guitar and Daly Roth doing whatever he was doing. which was trying to be some kind of Dionysian god, basically. Like the rites of Dionysus, you know. Pan, maybe he thought he was Pan. So these great non-dual teachers, you know, they just like jump off the page. They jump off the page. Just like Van Halen jumps off the page, you know. These great non-dual teachers, they jump off the pages of history. They jump off of any page. You can't put them on a page, can you? We cannot. And so you say, hey, I got great faith that you're not on any page. You're off the page. You jumped off the page, no question about it. And so this is doable. And you're telling us that it's doable. They're the ones that tell us, yes, you can. And Jesus tells us, yes, you have to. There's no way around it, eventually. And on my mom, same thing. If you don't get it done hit now, she says you get a return ticket. You got to get it done, eventually. So they jump off the page and say you can jump off the page too. In fact, you're not even on the page. How do you jump off the page? By realizing you've never been on the page. How do we all jump off the page, realizing we've never been on the page, and taking it like that? Instead of saying, oh, I just jumped off the page. Like, oh, I'm just enlightened. No, I've never not been enlightened. Take it like that. But I think it might be better to say, I've never been on the page. Because enlightenment is something that gets us thinking too much. And just say, I didn't jump off the page. I've never been on the page. I just realized I've never been on the page. Oh, what page? Page of time, space, process, and form. Nothing's ever been on that page. That page doesn't even exist. So this is a different way. See, this non-dual way of looking at it, and it brings up this deep wow. I'm feeling it right now. By going over it like this, you know, it's just by practicing in this way, stating this, affirming it, you start to shake inside and tremble. Just say, wow, this is really, really heavy stuff. And so then we're just quiet like this. We just sit still. Had a dream last night. It was really quite something. We climbed these tall trees. Everyone was living up in these trees. Beautiful trees. And there was someone up in the tree that was... Someone who's pestered me in my dreams most of my life. Terrible, terrible. Always very angry and hostile to me. And he was up in these trees too. And he was trying to teach me something. Trying to convince me of something. And somebody from my right side came and reached over, and the limb that he was on, they just sort of pulled on it like this. Well, the whole limb broke off, and he plummeted all the way down, way down, and hit the ground. I said, oh my gosh, it's dead. Fell all the way to the ground. Wow, what happened? Well, I looked, the limb was completely dead. Completely dead. This branch on a tree was utterly withered and like it had been dead forever. Never was alive, actually. Because that's how dead the branch was that he was on. And then ultimately, you look, so how could a branch like that come from this tree, beautiful tree? Well, it didn't. It was just, we imagined that it was, you know, like it was growing out of the tree, but it never actually did grow out of the tree at all. It was just all our imagination. This dream shook me up big time. So, full stop on the wow. It's not that we, how do we get, how do we get here? It's realizing, you know, I've always been here. Everything has always been here. The here-ness is, everything has always been here. Both been here and not been here. Both been manifest and not been manifest. All manifestation, all non-manifestation has always been here. Okay, devastating. We're going from worshiping time to honoring time. This put us on the path. This is repentance. Then we can listen to something like this, and we feel this, wow. Really shakes us up. This is what it's all about. You got to be shaken up. Shaken, not stirred. Good way to put it. Shaken, not stirred. Stirring is the struggle. You know, we don't want to stir it up, but we want to shake it up. We want to feel shaken, like, wow, everything has always been home. There's only home. Don't try to grasp this. It's pure abstraction. There's only home. It can only be experienced. Constantly. So how could this be something the body generates? Because there's only home. Then whether the body's alive or not alive, there's still only home. So this feeling experience can't possibly be something that comes from the body, can it? It can't come from anything, actually. It's always present. It's always present. Whether the body is present or not present makes no difference. Where anything happens to be present or not present doesn't make any difference. Everything is always, both everything and nothing is always home. I mean, the manifest and unmanifest. By saying nothing, I mean pure potentiality. Both the manifest and the unmanifest are always home. There's only home. So, it's not something that the brain or the body or anything is generating this experience or having this experience. Is having it meaning that it cannot have it. It's not possible to not have it, actually. It's not possible to not be home. We can imagine that we're not home, but we're not really experiencing when we're imagining like this. It's the difference between imagining and experiencing. Imagining is like a denial of experience, trying to trick it, saying that God, this is what you really create, is imagining, not experiencing. But we're still home. All the imagining is still home too. It's always been home. There's only home. There's only home. Why can't we meet with these non-dual teachers while we're sleeping? You know, this is the question. Occasionally, I have actually, but it's not steady. You know, so this has got to be my own fault, you know, because I'm honoring time by not having it be steady. That's all there is to it. And by time, we're meaning time, space, process, and form, which. It's just an idea that lasted just an instant. Didn't even last. It just was a moment, instant idea. Next instant, we're not having entertained that idea. It's not an idea we can entertain, really. You said, oh, okay, can't entertain that one. And next. So when we're honoring time, especially worshiping, but honoring time, is we will not have this continual realization that we're home because we kept throwing time into it. But what does time say? Well, we're not home. We have to get home somehow. And that applies to time, space, process, and form, doesn't it? We have to get home. Well, if we have to get home, home can't be here, so it must be at a distance from us. If it's a distance from us, it has to take time to get there. And getting there is a process. And what is it that's getting there? A form, right? Something has to get there. If nothing's getting there, how can we say that there's distance, time, space, process if there's in form, right? So it's all one basket of time, space, process, and form. So we should not bemoan the fact that maybe we don't have some great, you know, cornerstone sage in the world at this point. I don't know if we do or not. Maybe they're not known to me or someone else necessarily. I know people throw up all sorts of candidates and whatever. But, you know, we've had, like, we had three in a 15-year stretch there in this world just not so long ago. And, of course, America, you know, so we've had enormous help here. Over the last 50, 60, 65 years, you know, enormous help. Three of the greatest sages in the history of this planet. And again, we don't argue who's the best, who's better, Halen or Van Etter. No, they're both a total package. You don't compare them as guitar players, it's just a total package. What do you like? You know, what do you like? It's ridiculous, these arguments they have about, guitar players have about, oh my God. This is a sure sign of dualism, of being stuck. And there's some wiser heads that get on these YouTube videos, you know. I mean, the guys, the people just go nuts about it, cursing each other, saying they should die, you know. How dare you say this? No, this one's the greatest. And then someone says, hey, guys, if you like it, just enjoy it. What's your problem? I mean, it's crazy. It is. I know. I used to be there. I know. I understand it. It's a kind of madness. And it's spiritual, you know, it's dualism. You're struggling. You need an outcome. You need to find home. You know, what they're really saying is, which are these guitar players is playing from home, you know? Tells me the way back home. Well, there isn't any way back home. There's only home. Just like these great sages, you know? I mean, maybe you have your favorite or something, but you love all of them. You love all of them. I love all the great guitar players. You know? It's great. Love it. You can name all sorts of them, on and on and on and on and on. So, yeah. Love it. So, the great sages, love them all. Any time spent arguing, you know, is time that we're in severe delusion. What are we arguing about? We're already home. There's only home. So we're arguing why? Our angry why? And again, there's nothing wrong with having favorites, absolutely. But don't even, if it's your favorite, it's your favorite. That's it. But it helps, again, to have others that you love and can go to. When someone attacks your favorite, don't get an argument. You know, if you have a problem, say, wait a minute, let me start thinking about this. They want you to think about it. Say, I don't, let me shift over to this one. Be flexible so you don't get trapped in this comparative thinkingness, which the ego wants you to do. There's only home. There's nothing to compare home with. So the habit of comparison is a very nasty habit to get into. It's called, Jesus calls it judgment. He says you've got to drop judgment. It's a very bad habit. There's nothing to compare home with. There's only home. So when we're judgmental, we're comparing. It's dualistic. We're saying, okay, I like this home better than this other home or whatever. What is this? Okay. Maybe I better end the video here. All right. Very great.